tigers, monkeys, polar bears, lions, elephants, they're all here. But many of these creatures died centuries ago. But here they are, living on in a way for everyone to see. I guess that's the magic of taxidermy.
It's the art of preserving a dead animal's body for display. And for at least 500 years, it's been a somewhat strange but popular thing to do to our dearly departed friends.
Now, I know what you're thinking. Well, I know what you're thinking. Why? Well, I know exactly who to ask. A real-life taxidermist.
Joe's been preserving animals here since he was 15.
Hi, Amelia. How are you doing?
Hi, Joe. Thanks so much for having me here. This is amazing.
It's good to see you.
Oh, well, I guess my first question for you as a taxidermist is, why do we do this?
Well, taxidermy is a very old art, has a very long history, and originally it was to aid zoologists in describing new animals from distant lands. You know, travelling to all corners of the globe, they were bringing back all this material to be described scientifically. Now, during the Victorian period, people thought, wouldn't it be great to have an elephant in the dining room? And so they went out, got these animals, and Victorian taxidermists made a huge business putting these things in everyone's houses, and it became, you know, quite the thing. Every house had to have their taxidermy items.
While dead animals in the dining room isn't as fashionable as it used to be, Joe says taxidermy is still a great way to learn about animals without the risk of getting eaten or anything. And don't worry, Joe doesn't kill any of them. In fact, some of these guys lived long lives at the local zoo.
So we try and take animals that have died of natural causes, present them in museums so people can understand what they do, where they come from, and why they're important.
It can take anywhere from a day to months to make creatures come to life. First, they have to be fresh and free from decay, so they're kept in this freezer. The insides are removed and the skin is treated with chemicals, then very carefully glued and sewn over a foam body, like this one. And then it's time for the finishing touch.
Starting with eyes, you start here.
Wow, look at that. That's amazing.
Well, when anyone looks at someone else, the first thing they look at is their face. And it's the same with animals. And faces portray character, and you can deduce a lot about that animal by looking at the face. I really like the owl eyes.
Yeah, I can see that.
Of course, taxidermists have sometimes stuffed it up. For example, the extinct dodo didn't really look like this, but for a long time people thought they did based on some bad taxidermy. And then there's Melbourne Museum's famous sad otter. Aww. It was part of the museum's wild display, which recently closed after many years. Part of the reason was that taxidermied animals need a lot of care and protection from insects. See Adelaide's sad bunny.
And that's what 2 weeks of clothes moths can do to a mounted animal.
Joe says it helps a lot that most of his museum's animals are behind glass. But these guys are only one part of Joe's job. As a taxidermist, he also puts together skeletons and makes replicas. And while taxidermy might seem like a dying art, Joe says it's definitely a career to consider if you're interested in the business of giving creatures a second life.
Pictures in books are fine and movies are great, but standing next to the animal, there's nothing like it.